All right. So as I said, we've got a decent amount of information to talk about here, so we'll get going. And my first book, Anywhere But Here, delves into this subject matter of the left and right hemisphere and how it applies to spiritual work. Now, there's a lot of other material out there. Sam Harris wrote a book, and in it he has a section, and it's a book for secular spirituality, if you will. And in it, it has a section, because he's a brain scientist, on the left and right hemisphere. And it's decent. It's pretty brief. Ian McGilchrist is another person who does amazing work with this. His is more clinical and has really no interest in spirituality, though his conclusions about how the world gets basically more and more separate with the left hemisphere's dominance is a spiritual point. And then lastly, of course, we've got Jobel D. Taylor, who has had, through her direct experience, has had a spiritual experience. I have had a brief correspondence with her back when I was depressed. She was very lovely, and she talked to me, and she told me some things. And one of the things she told me later, once I had kind of done this, was that she wasn't going to be writing any spirituality books based on the left and right hemisphere. So unfortunately, that task fell to me. I would have rather she had done it, but it had to be done. So we're going to expound on that today. We're going to talk about the left and right hemisphere and how it applies to spiritual work. But before we get down to how it applies to spiritual work, first we kind of have to discuss how it works in general. And so to save time, because there is a lot of excellent material out there. Again, I would say Ian McGilchrist, The Divided Brain. There's a TED Talk with animation that's absolutely outstanding. I put it in Do the Work just before we started. Not that anyone would have the time to watch it, but you can watch it afterwards. Jobel D. Taylor's Stroke of Insight book, another really good one, because she basically walks through the left and right hemisphere in terms of how we perceive reality and the way that the death, if you will, the brief death, well, 8 years, of her left hemisphere led to a shift of perception. And it's not stunning that that would happen once you get what these two hemispheres do. Because the left hemisphere's job is to constrict, restrict, and to make small this unbelievably vast universe. That's what it is. It's a tool to create a fake version of reality. One that is utilitarian, which means that has direct use to me. Okay? So that's the actual job of the left hemisphere. It in no way, shape, or form has anything to do with reality. And in fact, it is in constant conflict with reality. Every time that human beings bump up against reality, it's usually because one of their narrowed left hemisphere conclusions is bumping up against the fact that those conclusions aren't real. Then we can go into extreme and obvious, and I may later discuss, for instance, how this plays out, say, in politics or whatever, how the left hemisphere tries to control things, and in doing so, comes up with more and more and more insane approaches in the hopes that it will one day get this thing under control. So, very simply, the left hemisphere is Oh, we just lost power. Are you guys there?
I can see.
We have light.
Okay, we had a lightning strike.
Well,
can you just hit your...
The TV may have just gone out, so hold on. That maybe all
right. Right, just the power.
Yeah, we had a lightning strike, and my TV didn't like it. See, this is a good example of the left hemisphere's desire to control. We're here with this idea that we're gonna go ahead and have a satsang, and everything's gonna go well, and we're gonna control the outcome. And then the universe comes in and says, "Have you considered light?" No, I didn't, in fact. And so that's the goddess stepping in to give a very good example, in fact, of the desire to control an outcome and reality disrupting it. That's wonderful. Thank you, goddess, for that little bit.
Perfect timing.
Perfect timing, as always, with the goddess. So the left hemisphere is unbelievably important. Because I'm going to villainize this thing, I'm sure most people who are listening to it think I'm going to villainize it quite a bit. But that's really in response to the fact that it is held far too highly, if you will, in this culture and in the world. So I'm really not villainizing it. I'm just kind of bringing it down to size, which is unbelievably hard to do with the unbelievable influence it has over modern society. So what's the left hemisphere good for? Okay, well, let's talk about some basic stuff. Ian McGilchrist gives an example that the left hemisphere looks at a map. And when we look at a map, it's just too much data, right? But what we want to do, we want to get to Denver. And so we put a little pin in our place, and then we put a pin in various places along the way, and then we put our last pin in Denver. We take the information on the map, and we narrow the focus down to just the data it takes to get to Denver. Now, that's what the left hemisphere is fantastic at doing, and in fact, it's unbelievably important for us as a navigational tool. We as a form. That's what it's for, okay? Another thing he talks about is that in the divided bird brain, that the bird is on the ground, it's looking for seed, and so it narrows its focus down, and it starts finding seed, and it's pecking at the seed, and the right hemisphere is keeping guard for predators. We see this all the time. And Mr. Tate took on a predator bravely the other day in the form of a snake that was eating some birds. But again, this narrowing of focus so that it could find food in the first place. You see? If you had Joe Bolte Taylor's large collage of oneness, you wouldn't be able to pick out one small little bit of seed. It would be, you'd just be sitting there, and trust me, it's a lovely state. I'm in it quite often. In an open, connected, beautiful space. And you would need. So the form has a very specific set of needs, and the left hemisphere is here to bias those needs. Does that make sense? Bias those needs. Make those needs more important than they actually are in reality. Because a bird seed is just bird seed. It's not more or less important unless you're a bird, you see? Once you're a bird, then the importance of bird seed starts to increase, and your left hemisphere then increases the importance of the bird seed. Artificially, mind you, increases the importance, okay? The universe doesn't hold the same. I often tell people when they talk about the importance of humans and the specialness of humans, especially in the religions that make humans so important, I say, well, I'm not sure God holds your view. And they say, what are you talking about? I say, well, I'll tell you what. Why don't you run head first into that big block of concrete and see which one God prefers? God made the concrete. God made you. Let's see. Let's try this theory out that humans are so important. Go ahead. And then there's often a pause, and then a screw you, and they stop listening to me, which makes my job easier, right? So, in other words, the universe does not seem to hold these same values inherently that our narrow left hemisphere doesn't. That's the point of this thing. That's why this thing is useful. That's why this thing is a beautiful tool. You've got Einstein's quote about, you know, the intuitive mind and the rational mind, and that the rational mind is a tool. It is. It's just a tool. It's just a tool in the same way that if I had some binoculars and I used it to narrow my focus so that I could see a target in the distance and ignore all the rest of this stuff, it's a tool. We would say those binoculars are useful at narrowing down our focus. Right? But to say that the binocular view is now the view of the universe is where the left hemisphere goes really wonky. It gets really out of whack when it starts believing its own press. And by the way, since the left hemisphere is where the language is, it has a press agent. The right hemisphere, the poor right hemisphere doesn't. And so when I say believing in its own press, while the metaphor is accurate, it's also not even a metaphor. Because it has its own press agent. That constant chatter is the left hemisphere selling you its case. Which is why there's so much in spirituality about finally ignoring that chatter. You see? The left hemisphere is talking and talking and talking, telling you how important birdseed is, telling you how important this is, telling you how important it is to have a very controlled environment. It's pushing and pulling against reality. It's in constant conflict with reality because reality as it is doesn't hold its values. Now, again, for form maintenance, that left hemisphere is not just a lovely tool, it's mandatory. There's a cool thing, though, about the left hemisphere is it doesn't need our help. Most of the functions that keep this body alive are actually unconscious, lower-level stuff. Breathing, eating, you know, I won't go on. You get the point. And so the left hemisphere really kind of gets a little overhyped in its necessity. Do we need to search for food 24 hours a day? The left hemisphere says yes. Because that's its only function, is to do these very narrow survival-based tasks, right? So if you ask the left hemisphere, should we be in constant search mode? It says yes. Now, what that does to the body, of course, is unbelievable stress. What that does to the ability to actually connect with others and be joyful and find happiness is it shuts it off. Who has time for such things? So another wonderful analogy that Ian McGilchrist talks about, he says if you're a general and you're preparing for this terrible battle and the survival of your nation state is at stake, and you ask your underlings to go and examine the battlefield, and they come back and they say they have lovely flowers. It has lovely flowers. I mean, the fragrance of these flowers is unbelievable, sir. And the general goes, lovely, but what's the terrain? Is there high ground? Can we get an advantage? Is there a place where we can narrow their troops? What? Oh, well, there's also some lovely fruit on the trees, right? And the general's very frustrated because the general has convinced him or herself that this is a very important survival-based activity and flowers and fruit don't come into it. And so you can see the left hemisphere now saying that flowers and fruit aren't important. It's very interesting to see that in most of the folks that I see on screen, you guys are muted, were laughing when I suggested that flowers and fruit would be one of the things that the general's assistant suggested. Because flowers and fruit in a battle, that's absurd. You can hear the left hemisphere. That's absurd. Flowers and fruit in a battle, that's crazy talk. And so what did it do? It diminished the value of flowers and fruit. Did you see that happening in real time? It said, those aren't important. Now, because I said war, because I said battle, the human brain goes, okay, right? Because behind my line of brave soldiers, well, there's children and there's the elderly and we need to protect them and we're going to fight. Okay. But remember I said that the left hemisphere has also got its own PR system. What if none of those things are true in reality? In fact, nine times out of ten, what if you're the aggressor? If you're in this country, the United States. When you've convinced yourself of the necessity of this thing. Well, now, you can decrease also unbelievably, the human brain is able to decrease the value of the life on the other side. That the humans on the other side of this battle now have less value than the humans on this side of the value. Again, a left hemisphere thing. And within the left hemisphere, this all makes unbelievable sense. It's very simple. You can walk people through it. Do you value your child? Yes. Do you value your child over other children? Yes, I do. And you could and it's kind of an embarrassing thing, but a parent would have to admit, well, I do. I do place the value of my child over these other children. Okay, well, that's the beginning of a war. That's the seeds of war. Once you've made that first decision that one thing is more valuable than the other, leading all the way up to a massacre of the opponent because your children are behind you, really isn't that far-fetched. And this is all the left hemisphere deciding, okay, that thing has more value, this thing has less value because it's linked somehow to my survival, and I've turned it into some birdseed. I've turned it into a thing that I must have. It's unbelievably important. Without it, I die. Okay. Good luck with that. Because as we've seen in this satsang, that when the goddess decides to throw some lightning, everything changes. When the universe starts to show that neither side has more value, in this war, now there's just blood, death. You see a lot of these veterans that come back, and they, especially for the United States, because we're almost always in someone else's country, and they meet the indigenous people, they fall in love with some of the indigenous people, then after a while, the enemy just looks like someone they love. It doesn't work anymore. Same thing, you know, people malign social media, and trust me, there's plenty to malign, especially the way the left hemisphere approaches social media. But one of the upsides of social media is that we're connected. In fact, one of the people in this chat is sitting in a country many miles away. And my mind, since I've known her for so long, this is young Lucy here, considers her part of my tribe, see? Because the mind creates those little tribes. How can that be when she's so far away? Right now, if the United States and England got into a war, it would make me very upset. So the upside to this expansion of tribe is that it changes the value within the left hemisphere, you see? Same thing happened with gay marriage not too long ago. Gay people were the outside. They're not allowed to have these rights. And then slowly, and actually it wasn't slow at all. I'm old enough to remember when this stuff would have moved at a snail's pace. There was literally, I think it was in the span of 3 or 4 years, a poll done where people were against it, and then all of a sudden a poll done where they were for it, and all that happened was people talked about it. Enough people talked about it. Enough people went, actually, you know, my uncle was gay, and I loved him. All of a sudden, it expanded. I remember watching the movie Harvey Milk where he was talking about that, and unfortunately he had to die for it. He was talking about exposing the gay community so that it wasn't just beating up people in the streets that don't deserve to have value. Again, the same insane issues that we deal with over and over and over when the left hemisphere decides that its controlled version of reality is important. It's not. It's not even real. However, we're not. I've started maligning it. I said I was gonna talk about how lovely it is, and I think I've run out. But linear calculation is fabulous. No mathematics without it. The ability to overlay an abstract version of reality on top of reality is in large part a left hemisphere, though it's a frontal lobe thing as well. Ability to narrow down focus. So I'm sitting in a house without the left hemisphere. These houses don't exist. But notice, if for those of you watching, and if you don't believe me, I can see it in all of your walls. Look at all the lovely symmetrical patterns we have. There's a square there. There's a square there. There's a square there. They love circles. Loves this stuff because the left hemisphere loves control. And squares feel very, to the left hemisphere, it feels like, okay, this is contained. This is controlled. I've got this now. All you have to do is leave one of the sides of the frame, like above baby's head. If you took one of those sides off, the left hemisphere would go, oh, all right. If it was uneven, thanks, baby, for that illustration. Then the left hemisphere goes, oh no, fix it. and because the left hemisphere has a PR campaign, and the left hemisphere never shuts up, we often just fix it, don't we? Right?
Yes.
Because rather than listen to this thing freak out about a picture, oh, it's just easier to just fix the damn thing, right? So we do. Not realizing then that one moment we have agreed to become its slave. We create this. It's funny, you hear so much about dysfunctional relationships and codependent relationships, and we create a codependent relationship with our left hemisphere where we're constantly taking care of it. Well, what happens in codependent relationships is the same thing that happens in the brain, is the codependent one, the one that's being overly fed, gets out of control because they're not in charge of their own world. So the left hemisphere, now that it's made this demand, okay, I demand that you fix the photo because it's askew. We give that, and then it says, well, what else can I demand? You see, these brains really were meant to go for about 30 years. Evolutionarily speaking, these brains were meant to go about 30 years, and then we're supposed to die, you see. We're only supposed to gather 30 years of this anally retentive, insane shit. Yes, Joe? Do you have a question?
So, talking about how the pictures you, then there's OCD. Yeah, about OCD.
Yeah.
And so it's like OCD, a far left extension of the left hemisphere, to have it just so.
OCD is essentially a combination of the left hemisphere's version of the utopian reality and the amygdala joining in to tell it how frightening it is when it's not. Did you hear me, Jill? I'm sorry, was I speaking when you were speaking? Did you get what I said, Jill? If not, I'll repeat it. So OCD is essentially the left hemisphere's utopia, which is controlling everything, and the amygdala coming in and telling it that its fears are real. And so the two get linked, and you know Hebb's law, neurons that wire together, fire together. So now the amygdala and the left hemisphere are in cahoots, telling you how terrifying it is when the world's out of control. And then you can see how the more that gets used, the more that control comes in. And again, as I was just saying, this left hemisphere balance, this marriage was only supposed to last 30 years. Because if you take a look at humanity, the evolution that built this machine up here really died out at around 30, often less, sometimes more. But once you get older, now this control mechanism starts to become more narrow. It's well known, you get in the dating pool and you're 50 plus, and you look across and you see the other 50 plus, and you think, oh, I don't want to learn all of their taboos and bullshit and nonsense, you know, it just looks like a headache. Because everybody knows that the older the mind, the more set in the ways it will become statistically. Why? Well, because the left hemisphere has had many years of saying, fix that photo, and us going, okay. And then it says, oh, okay, also fix that, and 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 that, until we narrow into what's comfortable, and then we believe it. Not getting that the comfort, that rather the discomfort, was supplied by the very same mechanisms.
That's crazy to me.
The left hemisphere and the amygdala beat us up, and then in order to not get beaten up, we give in. The problem is the left hemisphere, there is no end to this, you see? There's no enough to the left hemisphere. There's no enough control. It's convinced, this is why spirituality, where you hear it so often, you're not a little me, you are the universe, you're connected, you're not disconnected, because all of those are the opposite of the left hemisphere's view. The left hemisphere will continue to narrow as long as you let it, as long as you feed it with your awareness, you see. So, again, I'm about to go to the side where everyone's going to say I'm villainizing it. But it is an unbelievably important tool for form maintenance and form navigation. It is an unbelievably overused tool for form maintenance and form navigation. It simply isn't needed. If one sits with a conscious state, an open conscious state, and watches its day. If that's what if you do, if you'll sit and watch your day, you will be shocked at how few times you're in a real need for survival mode. In fact, in this world, with houses and refrigerators and food and safety and a lack of predators, my Lord, it is even less. It is unbelievable. You could literally, if you're really, 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 really observant, notice that a couple of times a day, the amount of survival mode you need is, where's the fridge? And where is the bathroom? And how do I get to my bedroom so I can sleep? That navigation, see? I might be in the other room, and I don't want to sleep on the floor, which, of course, you could. But I want to go to the more comfortable bed. And so I navigate my way to the bed and I fall asleep. I navigate my way to the bathroom because I don't want to poop on the floor, pardon me. And then I navigate my way to the fridge because that's where all the food is stored. That's where the bird seed is. Okay, cool. And that needs major control and left hemisphere plans, plots, and schemes. How? It's almost absurd. In this particular environment, if this was a person living, say, in Africa, in a jungle in Africa, and they had to sleep with predators literally all night looking for food, I might say to them, yeah, maybe keep a watch. Certainly build a fire. See, there are survival strategies that do increase the odds of survival. And the left hemisphere, if they've come across them, by all means. And if it's becoming nighttime and you can't get your fire going and the amygdala wants to come in and say, this is dangerous, we need that fire, you can see how this is not necessarily a terrible thing. To prioritize the making of the fire. To decide that the making of the fire will lead me to, you know, sleeping all through the night. It may not, of course. You might be able to sleep in the dark all night and no tiger or panther or lion comes anywhere near you. Because they're, you know, busy eating monkeys. Or something else. But you can see this in monkeys. You can see all these the social agreements that the monkeys are. And you see this in the birds outside with the snakes. The social agreement in the monkeys are, you see a predator, you yell out. And it has a certain tone. I never knew that birds had a panicky tone that says there's a snake around until I moved here. Chipmunks, too. They'll go, chip, 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 chip. They'll get very excited when there's a snake around. And it tells all the other chipmunks, hey, watch out, snake. Snake's just trying to get food like anybody else. But these social animals have developed these mechanisms, and they implement them. By all means, do so. Most of these things in humans at this point, though, are pretty second nature. But if in an uncontrolled, open, potentially hostile environment to take these various precautions before sleeping, hey, you know what? That's a good idea. Good for the left hemisphere. Well done. In this fortress I live in, with its perfect square windows, not so much. I literally can spend, because I have learned to be more conscious, and so I've looked, I literally can spend, believe it or not, days, weeks, without going into any real survival mode. In fact, what I notice among most people is 9 times out of 10, their biggest stressor is a status reduction, not an actual threat to themselves. Just the other day, actually it was yesterday, a friend of mine posted something on a political thread of mine, and I thought that he was wrong. Turns out he was right. And at the end of it, I could feel myself go, huh, interesting. And my mind wanted to fight him and make a status threat. And I'm like, no, no, just make your point clearly and then apologize. But that status threat on social media, I can remember a time when it would have like bothered me for weeks. Oh my gosh, for half a second there, I was diminished in status. And now other people will think I'm less whatever, less intelligent or less worthy of listening to in these bloody satsangs. The goddess has yet to be that kind. Well, it's true.
Reluctant guru.
No, it's not a reluctant guru. It's just the reality that I can't tell you guys anything you don't already know. I'm just here to tell you that what your heart is saying is true and to encourage you to trust it. So it's a silly job. But that being said, this left hemisphere does have important tools in this form-based experience. Most of them are rarely needed. And I discuss a lot of the places in the 3 books I've written. And now there's more essays, Rick. I don't know whether there's going to be a 4th book. Goddess forbid. Where I talk about instances where it feels very compelling to listen to this left hemisphere. Status threats being an excellent example. My reduction in status will lead to a reduction in whatever. Especially, let's say it's at the workplace. And I've decided that the workplace is my survival strategy. That's how I survive. I'm a mechanic. That's how I survive. I fix cars. Now you'll see all kinds of insanity. Someone comes up with a robot that fixes cars, and now I have to be up in arms. I have to fight the robot because instead of saying, my God, there's a ton of different ways to survive in this unbelievably wealthy culture we have. As opposed to doing that, I then stay with my narrow focus and fight the robot and say, nobody fixes cars but me. And off we go. And it's a very compelling argument on the external. You look at this poor mechanic, you think he's being displaced or she's being displaced, and oh my gosh, and we need to help that mechanic save the fact that humans fix cars. And that's you can see conservatism rising from that view. Conserving that which the left hemisphere values. You can see this now, right? I said I'd get into politics later, but we're going to dip into it just a little. You can see that conservatism is desperate to reinforce the values it already holds, because it believes the left hemisphere saying, you're safe in this one small environment. Now think about if outside of that environment, there were people that had different colored skin or different sexual orientation. Ah, don't let them in my bubble. You can see that as a left hemisphere controlled environment. Now that you see what the left hemisphere is for, you maybe can have more compassion. Understand that they're terrified that their little survival mechanisms are being threatened. And we'll go into that later. Again, I have a brief political section I want to discuss. But the right hemisphere, finally, the champion. Okay. We're going to discuss the right hemisphere now. But before we do, love you, left hemisphere. Love you. Seriously, we're not leaving until everyone here kisses their left hemisphere on the forehead and thanks it for the tool that it is. It keeps the form safe, it thinks. Most of those threats are what's called false positives. They don't exist, but there you are. So before we leave this, before we villainize this thing, we're going to love it. Thank you. Thank you for what you do. You're a wonderful and important tool. The right hemisphere. What is this silly little nitwit? There's rain now hitting our roof, and my right hemisphere loves it.
It's getting stronger.
I wish you guys could hear it. Can you hear any of this rain? My right hemisphere loves it. Woo! What's that? The right hemisphere is wide open, connected in the present moment. This is the one place where Jill Bolte Taylor and I disagree, by the way. It's a minor thing. She says the left hemisphere comes online and says, I am, she said, I am. I disagree. The left hemisphere comes online and says, I am not. I'm not that, or that. The left hemisphere says, I am not. The right hemisphere is what says, I am. If you want more clarification, if you want more words, Mr. Gadatta Maharaj added one that's beautiful. He said, I am that. What's that? Says the left hemisphere, right? I want details. Any detail you throw at me, left hemisphere, I'm that. You see? The that is there to counteract the left hemisphere's need for details. Ramana Maharshi will leave off the that and he'll just say, I am. I am the rain. And the right hemisphere gives you this picture, by the way, this collage of the present moment, that your left hemisphere, the right hemisphere is the map. Remember earlier, the left hemisphere puts pins in the map? The right hemisphere is the map, you see? The left hemisphere says, I got to get to Denver. The right hemisphere says, here's your map. Have you considered Chicago? It's pretty cool. Do you ever get out to San Francisco? Great people there. The right hemisphere loves all of it. In fact, the right hemisphere wants to go anywhere the pins aren't. Oh, I've done Denver. Let's go somewhere else. This is awesome. It's more adventuresome. It's more connected. It absolutely does not understand division. It has no need for it. Everything, the left hemisphere is in constant conflict with reality. The right hemisphere is in constant connection with reality. In fact, there is no experience in the brain, anyway, of reality outside of the right hemisphere just giving it to you. Yes. Lucy.
Well,
Are you muted?
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, that's okay.
Is it the case that basically the left and right hemisphere just can't understand each other at all? They're just destined to be terrible bedfellows.
Well, the right, let me put it this way, this is going to sound amazing. The right hemisphere has no need for understanding, right? It doesn't need to put conceptualize things or abstractly, label things. So the right, funny enough, to the right hemisphere, the left hemisphere's chatter just is. Trust me, when you do more meditation, and you'll get to lean to the right, as Jill says, Bolte Taylor. And I'm sure Jill here will say, if she does her work. But as you lean to the right, you'll see that the right hemisphere doesn't hate the left hemisphere. In fact, it's rather, that's why Hotai laughs all day. Because it's comical what it does. Look how cute. Look at it. Look at it. It thinks that it's going to narrow everything. And oh, I love it. It's a cute little thing, the left hemisphere. Oh, look, it's afraid. It's afraid again. Oh, you cute. Come here. Mwah, 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 mwah. It just loves it. Now, the left hemisphere, though, I'm sorry, sweetie, I can't hear you.
Yeah, it's definitely the left hemisphere can't get the right hemisphere.
Now you're talking.
But the right hemisphere can see what the left hemisphere does.
The right hemisphere sees everything. It just holds everything in a big open oneness, right? Some of the things that it notices, though, it doesn't really give it a lot of importance, is the left hemisphere chatter, right? And the left hemisphere mechanisms. It's trust me, my right hemisphere would really rather look out this beautiful window because you should see the rain. It's gorgeous. My right hemisphere does not want to have this blah, blah chat.
They have completely different priorities, basically.
Oh, their priorities don't even overlap.
Yeah. So... I guess what I'm trying to say is, well, I mean, in terms of them working together, things like music, for example, is one of the things that they can kind of both get on board with and kind of not be offering different perspectives on.
Well, but they do. The left hemisphere chops up music into its linear patterns, and the right hemisphere feels it. Leans into it, connects with it. You see? So, while you need both to do music well, but if you notice, if you're asking yourself what time signature something's in, that left hemisphere is counting beats, isn't it? And loves it. And in fact, if you take a look at the way, especially Western music is created, it's a left hemisphere love fest. It's all linear, loves the little notes, it loves scales, it loves to go up so many octaves, and it knows what an octave is, and it doesn't want to be off pitch, does it? The left hemisphere loves Western music. But so does the right hemisphere because it's expressive, it's connected, it's emotive. And so there is a merging in music between the two hemispheres, right? Mm-hmm. But so is standing on a hilltop going, la 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 la. But the right hemisphere likes that one a little more. Because I didn't say anything, right? So the language center wasn't involved. And I was just emoting this thing's stuff. So the right hemisphere would prefer probably that as a musical expression a little bit. It tolerates the left hemisphere's need to control music because it knows that it's, you know, a fear-based little controller and it pats it on the head and says, okay, we'll go la, 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 la. We'll do that. Fine. So the two do merge, right? But the objectives of the two actually are different in music, you see? So they can actually be at odds. When the left hemisphere wants to control it more, the right hemisphere wants to express more, the two can actually be at odds, you see. Mm-hmm. But they do have to cohabitate in musical expression, kind of like The Odd Couple. Well, maybe that's such an old reference. None of the young people know. It's an old movie, great movie and television show about these two men that move in together after divorce that just don't have any of the similar, you know, habits. And so, but they now occupy one little apartment. So good luck with that. And comedy ensues. Thank you, Neil Simon. So in a similar way, the left and right hemisphere merge for many tasks. In fact, language itself is a left and right hemisphere merging. You see? But there are people who, during a discussion, are more focused on the facial features, on the body language, on the tone. That's all right hemisphere, you see? And then there, and I remember being one, there are literalists. What does the word you say? What does it mean? And have you expressed yourself well? And people would literally pound their heads against the wall talking to me because I was language police. Nowadays, I'm much more lean toward the body language and the tone, but obviously I need to. So does that answer your question, Lucy? I see you've muted, but have I taken over your response? Oh, hold on, you're still muted.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
Okay. If that
kind of confirmed it, really, that generally they have different
goals.
Aims.
Yes.
And goals.
Yes. Though the term goal to the right hemisphere is a joke. Because a goal and plan's a plot or a scheme or a plan. The right hemisphere is just sitting openly. So that's why the thing that has goals, the thing that has schemes, and the thing really that even has preferences, because the right hemisphere doesn't, is the left hemisphere. The right hemisphere just gives everything equally and loves all of it. It's playing in all of it. And the left hemisphere says, no, 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 no. I don't want to hear about the flowers and the fruit. We're about to go to war. You see? So the left hemisphere is the one with priorities and goals and strategies. That's the one that has those. And so if there's a conflict that you feel, the conflict is the left hemisphere's. I know that's amazing, but it's true. Only the left hemisphere has conflict.
It's like the anti-shanty quote that I put in the group, I think it was yesterday or the day before, saying your awareness is not battling with itself.
That's correct. That's exactly what that quote is about. Yes. The awareness, the open oneness, is not in a battle with anything. And battles hurt it. It shuts it down. It doesn't understand conflict or the need for conflict. It's connecting and loving, which I'll discuss later. I have some political examples of what I'm talking about. So the right hemisphere is the map. If you guys get the analogy with the pins in the map, the left hemisphere is the pins in the map. And the right hemisphere doesn't care what's on the map. All of it's beautiful. Every single sector of the map, which sectors are a left hemisphere thing, is just as beautiful to the right hemisphere. It's just as fascinating when it goes, oh, there's a lake over here. Oh, there's a river. Oh, trees, I love trees. It's just fine with all of them, you see? Because the right hemisphere is the connected state. Why is the right hemisphere in charge of reading facial expressions and body language and energy in the other human? Because that's what it does. It cares. It wants to know, is baby happy right now? If baby's not happy, then I gotta edit. Well, there's a thing. There, see, baby's expression changed to a smile. Now my right hemisphere goes, yay! See? And then the smile spread. We all smile. And if we all yawn, it'll do the same thing through mirror neurons. But their right hemisphere loves this connected space, you see. But there's no adversarial nature to it. And so...
Lucy's yawning.
Uh-oh, we got it. Oh, here we go. Chain reaction, Luce. Oh, here it goes. No, okay. No, it's going to go. Oh, it's like, you got me. Okay. Yawn incoming. Oh, another one, you evil people. But this is the right hemisphere playing, you see? The exchange of yawns, the exchange of smiles, the connection. If one person yawns, there's no reason why another person needs to yawn. And yet we do. Because we're one, you see. We're one, not a bunch of separate ones. We all have this bizarre need to yawn from time to time, and then it catches. Why do you think comedians would rather play a house of 100 or 1,000 than one? Because laughter also spreads, you see. Trust me, when I was writing comedy and I would hand a script or a piece to one person, I knew that I'd have to sit down and wait for the occasional laugh. Now, have that same script played out and in a movie and a group of people, and you get laughs all over the place because each brain finds a different part funny. And then those laughs spread. You can see laughs spread just like yawns. It's a lovely, lovely, lovely thing. Because that's where we are connected, you see. That is the realm of the right hemisphere. It likes the connected space. It is the connected space. Is Gene yawning now? Great. Everyone's yawning. But while you all take a nap, and I'll continue the talk. So, the right hemisphere is all about connection, and it's all about I am at its core.
There goes Rick.
Oh, we just lost Rick. It's all about I am at its core. The left hemisphere is about I am not. So if the right hemisphere is about I am at its core, let's say my description is more accurate than Jill Bolton Taylor's. Though if you listen, Jill Bolton Taylor says that the left hemisphere comes on board and says, I am, and now I'm separate from you. Notice she does put that into the description. So she and I really are saying a very similar thing. She's just noticing that the ego, turns on when the left hemisphere turns on. The sense of separate self, which most people call the I, is associated with left hemisphere functions, you see? And that's why spiritual teaching is all about transcending the ego, which is a left hemisphere constructed abstract version of me. And it's absolutely ever, there, here we go. I need to turn my visuals off. Otherwise, I'll be yawning for 5 minutes. I'm kidding. I don't mind messing with you. I don't mind. But the goal of spirituality to transcend this left hemisphere identity, which Jill Bolton Taylor so generously gave the pronoun I to, misses the point that there's another identity. That the simple I am, the open, connected, right hemisphere's version of I am, which she later ironically quotes when she says that the left hemisphere was shut down and all of her ability to speak, remember, blah, 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 even feel her body were gone. She then evokes the pronoun again, which I call the most important part of her talk, when she says, and yet I'm still alive. There's that pronoun again. She handed that I to the left hemisphere's ego earlier, and right there she gave that I am to the right hemisphere in that talk. And if anyone's worked with me, I'll tell you, that's the most important part of that entire talk, is that with all that stuff shut down, there's still some kind of I am that's alive. That's the I am of the right hemisphere. That's the connected I am. That's the I am of Ramana, of Nisargadatta, of Eckhart Tolle, Adyashanti, all these teachers. That's why so much of my work is about monitoring pronouns, describing which pronoun means what and where. Because language, unfortunately, since it's based in subject, object, verb, is a left hemisphere paradise. That's why the final stage in enlightenment is called beyond words. because it leaves that left hemisphere paradise. So one of the things I wanted, and I'll get to some general open questions here in a bit. One of the things I wanted to briefly talk about again was I wanted to talk about politics. But before we do, I wanted to say, at one point when she was talking about the two left hemispheres, she said, you know, for you computer scientists out there, the left hemisphere is a serial processor and the right hemisphere is a parallel processor. So for those who don't know, I'll just tell you that a serial processor is a linear processor that processes one thing at a time. And parallel processors can multitask. They can process on multiple things and come together and work in unison. And therefore not just sit with one thing at a time, you see. So that's why she used those as examples in the talk. So I'm going to make some very specific sort of generalizations here. And I'm going to tell you, I've written some notes here, and I'm going to go ahead and share them with you. But it's kind of a summation of this brief chat about left and right hemisphere. So the left hemisphere, these are important points. The left hemisphere is always at odds with reality. Always at odds. Fighting reality. Trying to narrow this huge map down into the little pins. So it's pushing and pulling against it. Grasping and pushing are forms of control. So the left hemisphere is trying to control reality. Good luck with that. The right hemisphere is in harmony, in oneness, connected with reality. Okay? So the left hemisphere is all about control and narrowing focus, and the right is all about connection and widening focus. Which is why when I contacted Gibalta Tiller during my depression, one of the things she said was, unfocus your vision. Because there's a narrow part of vision called the fovea centralis. That's the detail part. It's in the middle. It's about the size of your thumb and arm's length. It's not very big. And that's the playground in the left hemisphere. The other part, which is 99.9% of this collage you see in vision, is supplied effortlessly by the right hemisphere, you see? And so she said, you know, if you want to increase your right hemisphere activity, go ahead and blur your vision. So I did. And in depression, it was immediately relieving. Now I can add to that, now that I know better. Even your breath, move your attention to the inner body, and open your heart. Whoa, now what? It's called enlightenment. What's the even breath for? Well, as it turns out, the amygdala loves uneven breath. You ever hear someone crying? The amygdala loves uneven breath. So when you purposefully even it, see, take long, deep breaths. You hear this thing, right? Well, why even? Gives the left hemisphere something to do. Whoops. Shit, I told you a secret. All the counting, mantras, all of this nonsense, zazen, getting the posture perfect, that's to give the left hemisphere something to do. Whoops, cat's out of the bag. Meditation, so much about meditation, is just to give you the left hemisphere something to do so you can have a fucking break. So that's why the meditations I suggest are very targeted toward right hemisphere functions. I don't give out mantras. I don't give out koans. They're lovely. They really are. But I don't give them out. I give meditations that are absolutely targeted toward strengthening right hemisphere functions and strengthening the left prefrontal cortex, which is the part of the brain that inhibits the amygdala. Tells it, whoa, dude, chill out. We're fine. Chillax. And so that's the core of those three meditations I suggest. Is there anything wrong with koans? No. In fact, I had some koans in my day. I've done the mantras. I have explored the more transcendental versions of meditation. They're all lovely. But in terms of cementing and really centering yourself in this open, connected right hemisphere space with a strong left prefrontal cortex that tells all the limbic system, chill out, we're good, then these three meditations are the core that I found. That's why I give them. That's why they're important. And they are tools to strengthen the portions of the brain that will free you from the insane left hemisphere. That's what they're for. A lot of people can get a relief from the left hemisphere by going to spiritual talks like this one or gathering with friends. You see? And so that's why people love spirituality as a social activity. And they'll say, oh, when I'm at church or with my friends or this and that, I feel much better. You say, well, yeah, man, that's a connected space. Of course you do. Same with going to a dance hall and everybody dancing. Same with going to a concert and listening to the same music. It's a very connected space. The right hemisphere loves it. So, yes, you can take breaks from the left hemisphere by doing social activity. The problem is they're temporary. Meditation is the old bit about practice makes permanent. Practice makes permanent. I can hear my chess teacher saying it. I can hear other people saying it. Various sports coaches I've had saying, practice makes permanent, Mark. Get in your batting stance. Elbow up, not down. Who do you think you are? You think you play for the Reds? I can hear it. Bat level, eyes straight. I can hear them. But what about all the great baseball players that move their bat around? Those are timing mechanisms. Those are advanced mechanisms. You need to get the basics down. Oh. But I want to emulate Willie Stargell. He's my favorite batter. Well, Willie Stargell can get away with that. You can't because you don't have the skill. That's like people trying to be Eckhart Tolle before they have the skill. The reason why Eckhart can sit in the oneness 24 hours a day is practice made permanent. It helps when you have a shift of consciousness where the left hemisphere is just bloody absurd. And you just can't listen to it anymore. When Eckhart is in terrible, terrible, terrible pain, and he can't stand it anymore, and he can't stand himself anymore, and then he's thinking, well, wait a minute. How could I be two people? Which one of these two people is torturing me? And why am I listening? It helps. See? If you have those moments, like Eckhart had, or if nature supplies it, like Jill Bolte Taylor, just shuts down your left hemisphere, and you go, fuck, this is awesome! What was I listening to? And then she said she got to watch as the left hemisphere systems turned on, and she could say, I don't like what that feels like. Are you kidding me? I've been in the open oneness, and you're going to tell me I have to be petty or angry or greedy or small or competitive? No. No, I'm not having it. I'm just not having it. No thanks. She said, I didn't like the way it felt in my body. Well, for those of you, I can see one of my students who told me that she woke up every morning, every day with a tight stomach as the day began. You can see what these things feel like in the body. Or tingles in the legs, huh? I see another student of mine who has issues with their feet and legs. The body doesn't enjoy these constant adversarial states. So Jill Bolte Taylor got to see it firsthand. She got to say, Ew, no thanks. Anger, whoa, what is that? She didn't like the way it felt in her body because she had been at peace for 8 years. And once you have had peace, trust me, you don't go back. So it does help, these major shifts. My shift helped. I had a student, bless his heart, he's not with me anymore. But he used to say to me all the time, I could do the work from your side. I can't do it from mine. It's not true, but it's a great excuse, and there is some truth in it. Is it easier for me, after the shift, if you will, to do core work? Of course it is. Of course it is. Is it easy for me, after the shift, to ignore the ego? Of course it is. But it's also easier for a weightlifter to lift 300 pounds after they've been doing it a while. But nobody gets upset at that. They don't walk into the gym and say, if I can't bench press 400, I'm leaving. Screw it. They realize that large woman over there bench pressing 400 pounds worked her ass off to get there. They don't walk into the tennis arena and say, if I can't beat, well, I'm going to show my age here, John McEnroe, then I quit. I'm not even going to learn how to hold a racket. So it's an absurd premise when looked at ultimately. But is it easier for John McEnroe to hit a volley? Yeah. Yeah, it is. Is it easier for John McEnroe to get a successful serve wherever he wants it? Yeah, it is. I could switch to the U.S. Women's soccer team because they just won. Talk about their prowess at soccer. And everyone watching that realizes that those women have worked their asses off to get there. So the practice is unbelievably important to mastery. But mastery in this particular so-called sport is easy. Mastery is be what you already are. That's not hard. Goal! Here, you want to score again? Be what you already are. Goal! Wow, this game is easy. Standing in the way of literally just being what you already are is this insane chatter telling you that, no, don't relax. No, we're in survival mode. No. And so we can't be what we already are. Okay. So one last little point. I was going to talk about these two instances of politics. There was a young lady named Megan Phelps. And she was a part of the Westboro Baptist Church. The Westboro Baptist Church is a kind of a cult. I say kind of because I'm being kind. And what they do is they promote a very narrow description of Christianity, and they enforce that description with violence and hatred. Well, she was indoctrinated. She was born into it. There's a lovely article about it in the New Yorker. So, again, she was conditioned. She really had no choice here, folks. You can let any anger or hatred go. There's no reason to hate something that has no choice. But in order to push the agenda of the Westboro Baptist Church, she was given the job of joining Twitter. This is fascinating, because Twitter ate her. Not in the way adversarial people think, as in, we showed her, we argued her. No. What happened is that on Twitter, you kind of have to connect with people. And so she was connecting to a bunch of people in order to tell them how wrong they were. And one of the people she connected to was a nice Jewish man. And the two had argued philosophically many times. And then the young lady, of course, thought she had won all of her arguments and this and that. But the problem is that the right hemisphere went, this guy's interesting. I like this guy. And after a while, a lot like Lucy became part of mine, he found a way to get into her tribe, just into that one little part of the brain that says, this human face is a beautiful human face, and it's one of my faces. He was on a trip somewhere. I don't remember the particulars. Or maybe he wasn't. No, he wasn't. He was at home. And some catastrophe hit near his home, tornado, something, something. I don't remember what. And she found herself worrying about him. And so she asked herself, well, why would I worry about Satan? And it cracked the entire left hemisphere. Because think about the amount of control a cult is trying to, it's trying to narrow it down to just the cult's rules and the cult's garbage is it. You see? But the right hemisphere cracked her the moment she got into contact to argue, to teach this Jewish man that he's wrong. And then after, I think it was, she had gone back and forth with him for about a year or something. And then she heard about a landfall of some kind of catastrophe near him and felt concern. She felt the connectedness. And it shattered her entire worldview. She's now out of the Westboro Baptist Church. She was in it. She was one of their primary advocates. She was, in fact, she was one of their attack dogs. And now she's out. And people say, well, that's an interesting story. What's the point, Mark? The point is that here's what doesn't work to get people out of the Westboro Baptist Church. You're wrong. You're bad. You're this. We should kill you. I hate you. I hate you. That didn't work. What worked was befriending them. How does that work? It works because love is more powerful than hate. There's another gentleman named Daryl Davis. He's a black man. He's a jazz musician. There's a, I believe there's a documentary on Netflix right now that you can find. There's a, if you see a photo of a black man standing next to, I believe, a white man in a KKK uniform, and behind him he's got these KKK trophies, hoods that he's gathered, the black man. And these are hoods of people who've quit because he befriends them and they love him enough that they can't hate him anymore and they retire from the KKK. And he's got these, you know, trophies of hoods that he's retired behind him. Now, how do these people, how do these amazing people, how did that Jewish man put up with this Westboro Baptist Church girl for a year? See? Obviously, he saw her as she was. Broken, lost, and without choice. Similar thing in the KKK. It's not like people are born hating. They get taught to. And it's not hate, by the way, folks. We call them hate groups. These are fear groups. Fear that their little bubbles aren't going to work, that they're going to be penetrated, that somebody's going to tell them they're not allowed to have their bubble, so they're going to fight. Because the left hemisphere has narrowed their worldview so small that it's easily crackable, you see. You give a Zen Roshi a monastery for old KKK members, easy crack. Because they're so rigid, you just walk up and go, when they're done. As Alan Watts likes to say, it's the more functional personalities that are harder to teach enlightenment to. You give a Zen Roshi a group of Westboro Baptist Church folks, trust me, they're going to break. You cannot hold that rigid philosophy against the open teaching of a Roshi. They'll break inside of three koans. Because a koan is meant to frustrate the mind, you see. Because most people know about the sound of one hand clapping. And you see a lot of you go, people go, I know what that is. I've got the answer. And then the real frustration is that when you take that answer to the Roshi, and the Roshi says, no, go back. Because it's not the answer. And then they go, ooh. And then they say, oh, I got it. It's this. Just waving my hand back and forth. That's the sound of one hand clapping. And the Roshi says, no, go sit down. You can see the frustration mounting in the left hemisphere trying to get the answer right. Because, by the way, the answer to any koan, and I hate to ruin it for everybody, is there is no right answer. If you walk up to the Roshi in an open, connected space, anything you do is the right answer. Uh-oh. Now you can see why koans work. They were meant to frustrate the left hemisphere, literally to crack the thing open. Because if you are in Roshi's expected a certain amount of bhakti, of devotion. So if you go into a Zen monastery devoted to Zen, and the Roshi gives you this koan, will you try to solve it with great passion, with great earnestness, with great courage, you see? And it's unsolvable. What does that do? Well, it cracks the left hemisphere. I talk a lot about cracks. What are we cracking? We're cracking this little left hemisphere bubble we've created. Inside of which is a little me. I'm the one that likes this and doesn't like this. And I'm the one who prefers this but doesn't prefer this. And I'm the one who likes to do this and doesn't do this. And I'm the one who doesn't like them and does like them. That's the bubble. So we can crack it multiple ways. Zen Roshis have become unbelievably skilled at cracking these things right away. But then, as I recently wrote, then comes the dark work. Because what comes out of the egg when you crack it? A mess. The other way is the slower method. You drain the mess, and then you crack the empty shell. Actually, it's a mostly empty shell. Sorry, folks. You don't empty it completely. I know. Most of my students are on that path. They'd love to empty it completely. No. Nope. Even spiritual teachers, from every once in a while, you go, whoa, hey, there's some darkness. Cool. Adyashanti talks about how when he sees it, he salivates, gets excited, because he dives in and gets to destroy these things. He gets to free that trapped inner child, usually. And it's exciting. Because unless it's triggered, it lies dormant, you see. That's why Ram Dass's famous quote, if you think you're enlightened, go spend time with your family. Because a lot of your biggest triggers were created in that environment. And you go out of that environment, and you pick a mate that doesn't trigger you like your dad did, and you pick a friend that doesn't trigger you like your mom did, or most times you'd pick friends that do trigger you exactly the same way because you want to perpetuate that. And you get these, construct these environments, and then you go back home for whatever, Thanksgiving dinner, and you're in the trigger zone again. Or you, God forbid, you know, plan a wedding. Lucy looked at me like, what? I already did that. Well, there are other crazy people out there doing exactly that right now. Oh, no, I can't hear you, sweetie. I can't hear you.
I frown because you're breaking up.
Ah, I'm sorry.
No, because of what you were saying.
Okay. But you plan a family gathering of that size, their wedding, and you can see how crazy that can make you with all the triggers involved in it. So the work is never done. Not completely. But the relief of emptying the bulk of it is what we call enlightenment, you see? And how do we get to the so-called space of enlightenment? Well, as it turns out, in terms of brain mechanics, we lean to the right. Did it work, Lucy? Now remember that in...
Say yes, Lucy, say yes. I want it to work.
Remember that in brain mechanics, the right side of the brain controls the left side of the body, and the left side of the brain controls the right side of the body. So if you're actually going to physically lean, you're going to want to go the other way. Ian McGilchrist talks about how most people are right-handedly dominant because the right hand is the one that we manipulate with. So it's the left hemisphere's favorite tool, you see? The left hemisphere wants to grasp and push, etc. Now, if you're left hemisphere dominant, that simply means that those left hemisphere mechanisms have switched. It's still the same type of mechanisms. They're just now in the other hemisphere. So, what is the point? The point is what they call in Taoism effective action. Is it more effective to constantly struggle and fight against reality? Or is it more effective to connect with reality? Which one of these two tools is more effective for our daily experience? This is why I challenge folks to actually sit consciously for a full day and see how often you need this left hemisphere. Notice I didn't say you never need the left hemisphere. Because that's what every single student says to me when they finally start doing their work. What am I going to do, just sit around all day? Look at birds, look at the flowers, I got a battle to fight. Okay, maybe you don't. Well, yes, I do, you don't understand. If I don't do this and this and this and this, I'll die. Maybe you won't. And that's usually when they run away from me and get very angry. I need this stuff. Okay. If you're in the U.S., you need it, right? Okay, well, in the U.S., 5% of the population consumes 25% of the raw materials. How is it possible that they need all that when the rest of them, rest of the population in some way, shape, or form, though many are dying, are surviving without it? How is that need real? There's a fly in the ointment in this philosophy. It may not be necessary. I'm not saying it's not lovely. I like to watch Netflix shows as much as the next person because I don't mind entertainment, and plus I was in the industry. I like a well-crafted show. It's a lovely expression. In the same way that Lucy was talking about music, I can enjoy watching a show with both of my hemispheres. It's not necessary. You see? And it's important to challenge this left hemisphere's idea of what these necessary survival strategies are. Not to get rid of them, but to be sane. If you find out that the role of husband and wife or partner and partner is an abstraction and not real. Do you have to get rid of your partner? No. Okay, Lucy. I saw that. That was cute. She's nodding. But where is he? I know he's there. Does he have his shirt on?
I saw legs.
I saw something. But one needn't immediately rush out and get rid of the partner once they see that the abstract role we're playing is fake. It's a left hemisphere paradise. Aw. It's fake. That's fine. Just because something's fake. Notice I said I watch television, and it's fake, by the way. There are actually people who believe that it's real. God bless them.
Even reality TV.
Well, I'm talking about extreme, really, you know, mental illness cases. Like Harlan Ellison, who was a screenwriter, was giving a talk, and he had written a script for Star Trek. So he's talking about dialogue he had written for Mr. Spock, and this person stood up and said, "Liar!" and lit their hair on fire. Because Mr. Spock was real. And Mr. Spock says what Mr. Spock says. No writer tells it. So you can see that that's just an unbelievably extreme narrowing of reality for the left hemisphere to the point where it's dysfunctional. It's not effective action anymore. You see? Well, in what ways are we absolutely right with that lady in believing that abstractions are real? You see? And in exactly every case that we do that, we're ineffective. That does not mean we can't play. See, children get this. You get a group of children together and they say, "Let's play whatever." And they play the game. And then mom or dad goes, "All right, kids, lunchtime." They just disperse. Because the game wasn't real, but lunch is. They haven't lost their priorities. They're not insane. And then we all grow up and we start trying to make these things real. They're not. They're still lovely games. Lovely games. Beautiful games. Especially when they're done in love and connectedness. The destructive games like war, I'm not so fond of. But war's an abstraction. That's the enemy. No, it's not. This is my country? No, it's not. This is my religion, and my religion is right, and your religion's wrong. Because we both worship God. What? What? I'm going to kill you over the fact that you use the word Allah, and I use the word Yahweh. What? Stop it! Stop it! Stop killing one another over this nonsense. Ineffective action. You can see it all over the place. The food needs to be covered in something so that it doesn't go bad quickly. I know, let's wrap it in plastic. Solve that problem. Whew, now we've got a solved problem. There's no karma. And the beauty is in this talk behind me right now, you can clearly see the yin and the yang symbol. There's no dark half to creating plastic and wrapping it around everything. You know what we need? People need to drink more water because we've screwed up our water supply. I know what we'll do. Little bottled water. We'll carry it with us wherever we go. Problem solved. We don't have to worry about the fact that we polluted our water supply. We've got these little bottles now. There's no darkness. The left hemisphere, every one of its solutions, it's so cocky about, it's so certain about. There's no darkness. No, 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 no. Unless, of course, you're in the ocean and you're a fish. Or you're trying to traverse one of these plastic land masses that are now in the ocean. Then you can start to think, well, maybe there was. There's yin and there's yang. Who knew? There's creation and destruction. I solved the one problem and created another. Oh, my Lord. But I'm a problem solver. That's what the left hemisphere says. I'm going to solve all these problems. I'm going to go to war, World War I. I'm going to destroy these bad guys. I'm going to tell these Germans how horrible and broken and wrong they were because it's their fault. And there'll be no repercussions whatsoever. Nazi Germany, anybody? You mean beating up a bunch of people, telling them that they're responsible for an entire world war has no downside? Makes them, yeah, it's like I was talking about this the other day. If we were talking about fascists and fascist dictators, he realized that there are fascists everywhere. There are people that are so frightened that they try to control everything through fear and hate. They're everywhere. The question is, when does that dialogue become popular? When the society is ripe for it. How does society get ripe for it? Well, division, hate, anger, pain, suffering, and the pushing down through a dominance hierarchy of those on the bottom. It's ironic that Karl Marx talks about that, and now communism is a dirty word. It was a philosophy, folks. Get over it. And he was right. You cannot continue to funnel all the resources toward the top. It's not reasonable. It's not sustainable. So what happens? You do that long enough, and people get very angry and frustrated. And then you give them some extremist solution, and the left hemisphere loves it. We'll just eliminate all the bad people, and it'll be a utopia. No, it won't. All these attempts at utopias didn't quite work out well. Because the left hemisphere always creates as much pain and suffering as it cures. So if you've decided you're going to solve the world's problems with your left hemisphere, well, then you're going to have a world reaction in the negative karma that comes. The left hemisphere doesn't work. Guess what? I'll say this again. It's one of the things I like to say, but I'm going to go ahead and ruin the plot for you guys. The left hemisphere's job, which is to keep the form going, fails. Sorry, left hemisphere. You are given a losing task. It literally was handed, and the poor baby does the best that it can. Eckhart talks about how the ego does the best that it can. It has good intentions. The poor baby is literally set against reality from birth. That is, if the form is important. If the form is unbelievably important, and you're locked in a view that says the form is important, welcome to dukkha, suffering. If you're in the left hemisphere's world, you are suffering. And you cannot end the suffering with control. No matter what the left hemisphere says. The end of suffering is the release of control. Entering the world of the right hemisphere. Open. Connected. Understanding that all forms dissolve, including this one. That doesn't mean that you ignore it. Enjoy the ride. It's like getting on a roller coaster and refusing to enjoy the fun of the roller coaster because it's going to end. What are you doing? You like roller coasters? Yeah. Well, get on the damn thing. I'm not going to go to a concert because I know the concert will end. What? Do you love music? Yes. What are you doing? It's so absurd. No other place in our lives do we believe this nonsense. Especially with something we're passionate about and connected to. I'm not going to love this person next to me because, well, it'll end. What? And that one's pretty darn common, isn't it? Shut down my heart. Never be vulnerable again. Mm-mm. Is that effective? How's that working for you? The adversarial mind leads to pain, suffering, dukkha. The connected one leads to love, connection, joy, happiness. And it's time that you guys choose. I can't choose it for you. If I could, you kidding? I'd wave my magic wand and be done. If I could nail myself to some wood, I'd do it. If it was actually going to free you folks, I'd do it in a second. People talk about Christ's sacrifice. Are you kidding? If Christ really felt that he was going to cure the sins, the missing the mark, the looking away from happiness, joy, love, from God, which were being nailed up, he was in bliss being nailed up. So would I be. So would any of you if you embrace the right hemisphere. If you tell the right hemisphere, it's that little girl, the one in Africa, when the man, the Westerner, puts the piece of candy or the bag of candy on the tree, lines them all up to teach them what a race is. It's a competition. The winner gets the candy. And the oldest girl, who could have hit her, she could have beaten all of the rest. They all lock hands and they walk together to the candy. The oldest girl, they all get there at the same time. So the oldest girl takes down the bag and gives candy to everybody. And the Westerner says, you don't get it. I'm trying to teach you this thing called competition. You do realize that if you had just outrun the rest of these smaller kids, you could have all the candy. And she said, how can I enjoy the candy when they're suffering, when they're not enjoying candy? When you're in that space, the form looks a lot different. It's lovely. But this particular form isn't as important. You can live a life of service. That's why bhakti, our karma yoga, works. Bhakti, devotion, giving away the importance of this form to something greater until you then see that you are that something. Sorry, give away the plot to that one too. Jnana, which is, God bless people who use jnana, going into this thing until you finally see it doesn't work, this mind. You go in, God bless you if you take the jnana path, because I did. You go in there and you examine it and examine it and examine it, using it against itself, and then it finally breaks down, much like the Zen Roshi's koan, and then the right hemisphere is just there laughing, going, had enough? And you say, uh-huh. And it says, well, come on over. God bless anyone on the jnana path. And Raja, which is the last path, is meditation. These are all the paths that Patanjali and obviously it predates Patanjali because he's quoting something, obviously, said were the four yogas, the four pathways to liberation. Where do they all head? What is the goal? The right hemisphere. So I wrote a book about it. And if you want more on this subject matter, Jubaldi Taylor is wonderful. Ian McGilchrist is, though I think he's a doctor, is wonderful. And if you're a glutton for punishment, you want more of my nonsense, my first book, Anywhere But Here, is about left and right hemispheres and the spiritual path. So that'll conclude my blah blah. And we can either end early and everyone go dance in the rain, or if people have questions, now's the time. First off, is everyone still here, baby?
It seems like they're connected. I texted baby and let him know that we can't see them.
So okay, but they're still here.
If they have a question, to unmute their mic or text me the question.
Okay. But this is the question. We can either all dance in the rain, which would be fine with me, or if there are questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Yeah, baby says they're still there.
Wonderful. Lovely. Okay. No questions. Because you guys got them in early. Well, I guess then what we'll do is I'll just chat for a bit and then we'll end this.
What's that one message down there on your Skype emblem?
Oh, it's Lucy telling us that her SO is asleep.
Okay. Okay.
Should we speak loudly? So, yes.
I have one question, but it's not really on topic, so I don't know whether to save it for another time.
No, you go.
Which is, so as you know, I've been doing the daily guided meditations,
mm-hmm.
At least once a day. And I've noticed kind of things that I've found more helpful when I'm doing them. One of the things that I've noticed is, like, if I have resistance, I think you probably answered this before, but I think it's just worth me asking it again. So if I'm, for example, feeling anger whilst I'm doing the meditation, so I can be focusing on whichever one it is, and then I'm feeling this anger. Is it, like, because I get the sense that that's like the little girl, rather than just simply my left hemisphere trying to distract me from kind of diverting the blood flow away. So would you suggest, what I've kind of been doing is, I'll kind of circle through focusing on the inner body and the breath, and then allowing that anger to be as it is, and then whichever meditation it is, I'll be focusing on. So for example, in the compassion meditation as well, during the bit that's repetitive, when you're saying focus on that person, you know, when you repeat the instructions, I'll just make sure to check in again to kind of make sure the inner body's still there. But then sometimes there's this kind of anger that I get, and I'm just wanting to be sure that, because I think if I try and push it away, then it just kind of comes back stronger. So I do try and hold that, even though that kind of seems counterproductive to the task at hand. I'm sorry if I'm not being very clear.
No, no, you are. I'm just waiting for you to be done, because I don't want to jump in.
Okay, no, I think that's it.
Okay. So the goal of meditation is to enter the realm of the right hemisphere, as we've said today,
mm-hmm.
right? The right hemisphere is perfectly fine with anger.
Yeah. So it's fine to just kind of allow it to be there and not to try and distract away from it.
Distracting away is a left hemisphere. If the left hemisphere will do with these meditations, and it does it all the time, it will decide that it has a goal and a purpose,
mm-hmm.
and it'll decide that it should feel a certain way. That's the one that's almost derails everybody.
Mm.
I was doing my meditations, and at the beginning, Adyashanti talked about this in that Dark Night of the Soul bit. At the beginning, I got such relief, but then, as I was doing them, there was just misery and pain, and suffering would arise. I must be doing it wrong. No, that's your heart opening.
Yeah, okay. So that is fine.
That's that old stuff coming up.
To hold that as well as focus on the... Cause I mean, there was one time when I thought, actually, I'm going to pause meditations and just be with this for a bit. Because it felt like it just needed to be heard.
Yeah, I would say two things. If it's in thought form, if it's in verbal form, then what you do is you turn to that thought and you say, you're important and I'll get to you after we're done. Okay?
It's generally not thoughts, it's literally just feeling.
Correct. I'm getting to that with my second half.
Okay.
So if it's in thought form, you turn to it and you say, I'll get back to you. Because otherwise, once the left hemisphere knows that it can interrupt you with verbal dialogue, it will never stop. Okay?
Mm.
So if it's in thought form. If it's an emotion, add it to your compassion meditation. Just let it be. Do your compassionate
mm-hmm.
meditation angry.
Yeah, okay.
Not do compassion with anger. Not side by side. Do compassion meditation in anger, if that's
mm-hmm.
what's there.
Yeah.
Not, I'll get back to you one day, I'm doing compassion meditation. You understand? I'm doing inner body meditation and anger has arisen. I'm going to do inner body meditation, get back to you, anger. No. My inner body meditation has opened my heart and out came this old anger.
Mm-hmm.
Lovely. That means you're doing it right. Because it's opening, you see? It's the exhaust and the intake valve. It's both. And that old anger needs to get out. What a lovely, lovely expression. Let it out.
Okay.
If you have to kick and scream and pound a pillow while doing inner body meditation, knock yourself out. But that's not what meditation looks like, says the left hemisphere. The left hemisphere isn't invited. There is no right meditation. There's only meditation. The guide,
okay.
The guide is there for a reason. Guide. It's not rules. It's not regulations. It's not restrictions, you see? It's just a guide for a general pathway through your meditation. If anger arises, then anger is now the meditation, you see?
So the most important thing is to allow everything to be as it is. Because obviously my only concern was that I'm trying to strengthen right hemisphere functions through stuff like the inner body meditation. But I guess allowing the anger to be, that's strengthening.
You can let go.
The
limbic system.
Anyway.
The limbic system is not in either hemisphere. Okay? The limbic system is its own thing. So anger, fear, sadness, all these limbic, you know, brain mechanics have nothing to do with either hemisphere. It's its own thing. So if they arise, they arise. The right hemisphere meets them with, oh, I love you. And the left hemisphere fixes them, pushes them, controls them. You see?
Yeah. Okay.
So that's why if you hear a spiritual teacher, what happens if I get triggered? Love it. I love you. You see? Meet it with a right hemisphere response. So in meditation, while I'm strengthening the right hemisphere, if a limbic response comes up, lovely. If the mind wants to talk about it, not so lovely.
Okay. Fine.
Okay.
And then I just had one other question.
Go ahead.
Sorry, guys. So one thing that I found when I'm doing the compassion meditation is this idea of wishing someone to be free of suffering. I feel like to the left hemisphere, that means changing reality as changing something. And so, I mean, do you see what I mean?
The left hemisphere is perfectly... The left hemisphere is perfectly capable of hijacking any words you use.
Yeah.
So the words are not important.
So
the words,
like the opening of the heart.
The words are pointing to a space where you're connected to them rather than disconnected.
Mm.
And the way that we can do that the easiest is to bring them into our joy. Bring them into
yeah.
our love, you see? So that's what the compassion meditation is an invitation to. It is not a left hemisphere
mm-hmm.
solve all for all suffering.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
This is hijacking. You have literally just found hijacking at its core. When the left hemisphere
yeah.
gets used to the meditations, it begins to hijack it. And it'll say things like, well, what's the problem if I accept what is? Why don't I care about, why do I care about whether they suffer? Ooh, I've read a book. It's wrong.
What I started to do when that happened was I just really focused on feeling the open-heartedness and the love. And that kind of, rather than trying to get it right and do all the steps perfectly.
There are approach and avoid responses in all brain mechanics, including the right hemisphere. And while the right hemisphere can stay open during pain and suffering, it much prefers love. You see? And so we're just nudging. We're just, it's a what they call a nudge toward the form. We're giving a nod toward the form and the form's least pleasant experience is suffering. It's not that it's good, bad, right, wrong, up, down, needs to be controlled, needs to be not to be controlled. It's not that. It's that when we are connected through love, our hearts open. It's a no-brainer, you see. Then comes the skill to be connected through love when there's anger or hatred. But you get the easy stuff first.
Mm-hmm.
Understand? At some point, you'll get to Christ's turn the other cheek. But the baby steps are to walk your way through there through loving connectedness, you see? The mind is...
Interesting. I had a really unpleasant encounter with a man in a shop the other day. And I chose him for my person at the end of the meditation.
I bet it was rough.
And it was interesting because that was the most, like, when I'd chosen him, it was the most heart-opening of all of them.
That's right. I bet it was rough because he was in active status threat. The brain had not rewritten it until it so what happens is if we feel a status threat, the brain, the left hemisphere, tries to fix it. See? Tries to fix the status threat. Oh, they're an idiot. I'm superior. They're not. See? While it's working for the right story that you'll buy, that status threat's still active. To do compassion meditation during an active status threat is very challenging. And so at some point, the left hemisphere will settle upon some story, and the ego will say, okay, I know what's wrong with them. They're, well, politics has happened, so it's constant, right? They're a Republican, so they're stupid. I now know. Okay? Now you feel better, and your status threat is resolved. Then after you've done that, you generously give them compassion through my meditation. That's the left hemisphere's version of this garbage. It doesn't work. The real challenge and the reason why the challenging person is in there is to show that the left hemisphere will never, ever, 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 I can say this 1,000 times, please do join you in this practice.
So what I meant was that it was the most heart-opening of all of them?
The result,
when I did,
the result was,
yeah.
Yes, because the heart was the most closed, you see?
Okay.
You understand? During the active status threat, we shut down.
Yeah.
Okay? So if I do this enough and it opens, it'll feel like a rose blossoming, you see?
Okay.
Which is why same as enlightenment. A honeymoon phase with enlightenment where it's such a relief and everything's great. In Zen, they talk about it's almost like you're floating 3 feet off the ground. And I think that was D.T. Suzuki's metaphor for Satori. Yeah, it does. It lasts for a while. Most of that, folks, is relief. Sorry. And then it settles. That's why people seek aha moments. Because in aha moments, oh, I see. Huh, you get some relief. They're seeking the relief. Ironically, relief from suffering. And that's why they don't work. That's why aha moments don't work. That's why gathering with your friends to talk spirituality doesn't get you enlightened. None of this stuff works because these brief escapes don't last. There has to be a practice that strengthens the part of the brain so that it becomes permanent. And then you get to see what Adyashanti points out with relief, which is what you feel when you feel relief is relief from the left hemisphere. Now, he doesn't say that. He says ego. But I'll tell you right now, every time you go, oh, God, I feel better, it's because the left hemisphere is shut up for about 2 seconds. That's what happens 1 year after when you get what you want. I want, I want, I want, I want. I've narrowed the universe down to this one thing. It's a very uncomfortable state, you see. Then you get it, and you say, oh, achieving that want made me so relaxed. Now, it's not searching for about 2 fucking seconds. Because you got this thing. And then, because if the thing, if achieving this thing actually gave you that relief, then having it would be the relief. But what? No, the new TV didn't work. My new mate that I got because I was tired of the old one, I got to be high for a while and then it faded. Better get a new one. I'll go get a new mate. Okay. You can do this forever. But what you're after, what brings on the relief, is finally having the left hemisphere shut up. But it only pauses for a moment, you see, before it finds a new target. But in that moment, it's rather blissful, is it not? If you get a new TV and you want it and you want it and, oh my God, I can't wait, you get it, you set it up and you turn it on and, of course, it doesn't work, so you have to, you know, go through that. But then you finally get it and it works and, oh, it feels so great, and then a week later, it's just your fucking TV. Now what can I want? You wonder why in the West we consume 25% of the world's raw materials? It's this. It's the desperate desire to get away from the left hemisphere. To these brief moments where, oh, I've gotten what I want. Oh. Well, that's why it doesn't lead to enlightenment. Enlightenment is the state of permanence through skill where you just don't listen anymore. And it is very, very, very useful to strengthen those right hemisphere brain mechanisms. Because anger arises, you know? Anger is simply the largest no you can say. That's all anger is. You tried the polite one. No thanks. Didn't work. You tried the medium one. Hey, man, I said no. Didn't work. What you got left? No! That's all that's left. So you use it. Anger is yet another tool for form maintenance. You understand? Fear is a tool for form maintenance. What if it really is a panther in the bushes, or a tiger in the bushes, I think I called that essay. Well, fear will check it out. It's just a tool, you see? Same as the left hemisphere. All of these brain mechanics are tools. Only the right hemisphere is the isness. The right hemisphere is the open isness. It's not a tool. It's the whole game. It's the whole ball of wax. The other ones work within it, you see? The other ones interact with it. That's why all these metaphors in spirituality, the screen and the movie, all these metaphors, you are the screen, not the movie. You're the observer. All these things, right? Though technically, the observer is also in the left prefrontal cortex from the position of I'm observing. I'm observing is actually here. Simple awareness, which is different, is the right hemisphere. Okay? Did I answer your question, Lucy? Oh, she's muted. I hope so.
Yeah.
Okay.
You did. Thank you.
Lovely.
Thank you. Sorry for being so rambling.
No. Rambling is what we're here for. All right, if anyone else has something? Yes.
Yes. Just a comment from having listened to the interview with Jill and Oprah.
Uh-huh.
A suggestion that you gave us long ago was to soften our eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And in this interview, she gave the suggestion for relaxing your eyebrows. And I found that really has helped.
Sure. Well, if you notice when you're serious, your eyebrows, your burrow, furrows, right? Anything, because the physiological responses and the mental responses are linked. So anything that puts you in a different state physically, the mind will, in time, have to acquiesce. So unfurrowing your brow, that's why I used to tell people to look up and smile. Real smiles. You do that long enough, the brain responds, you see? So then you can add to it, look up and to the right and smile. Or look up and to the left and smile. Real smile, though. It has to be the real, where you smile with your face and your eyes. You do that, and in time the brain aligns, you see? That's why power poses. That's why power poses work for gaining confidence. You see these things now. People have these power poses. And then the amygdala calms when you're doing this. You see? So yes, any of those tricks are very useful, and there's a lot of them. You can look them up. But unfortunately, since you can't drive while staring up, and you can't function in a power pose, you're going to need, and sometimes your brow's going to furrow. You're going to need a better, like my brow furrows when I'm looking at sunlight, you see? So you're going to need a more sustainable method, and that's where meditation and practice comes in, okay? Because when my mind comes in and tells me something's really scary and important, it gets a Buddha laugh. Yeah, sure it is. No, this is good. Yeah, okay, whatever. You know, you're going to do the satsang and no one's going to listen and no one's going to like you. Okay, fine. What a terrible reduction in status. No one will think that you're important. Thank God. Because status is a pain in the ass when you finally see it. Trust me. When you finally see it, you can be the lobster at the bottom of the tank that's just chilling, or you can be the one at the top that's constantly fighting to stay at the top. You get that the bottom lobster's got it better. But it's hard to tell the mind that. There are a lot more people in hunter-gatherer tribes with nothing in what we would call wealth that were unbelievably happy and enjoy. The mind has it backwards. So that'll do. It's 2 hours. Love you all. I hope this talk is of some use. Again, further material, Jill Bolte Taylor's book, My Stroke of Insight, Ian Gilchrist, which is, he's got a couple of them, I think, but one of them is called The Master and His Emissary. Here's some wonderful talks. There's a TED talk by him that's animated. It's really, really good. The stuff's out there. Even little Sam Harris's little bit on the left and right hemispheres in his secular spirituality book called Waking Up, A Guide to Spirituality Without Religion. All of these are sources for the more scientific pathway that we call liberation, you see. And without it, I would never have been able to do this work because I was very anti-woo-woo, and until I did this work and found out that woo-woo isn't so woo-woo. All right. Love you all.